Welcome to Vancouver City Mission Church.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Welcome back. Thanks again, Esher, for the warm welcome. Let's get started. We have a whole lineup of events happening today for online church. So my first announcement is always about prayer requests. Once again, we want to pray with you, pray for you. In this time of pandemic, it's very important that we come together and support one another and lift one another up. So make sure if you have any prayer requests, send them our way on vancouvercbc.org/prayer.
While we're on the topic of prayer, there will be corporate prayer happening next Wednesday, April 7th at 6:30 p.m. via Zoom. And giving is continued to be accepted online through Interact eTransfer, AdventCityBlessing@gmail.com, or payable through check. As today is the first Saturday of the month, we will be having Holy Communion, so be sure to prepare your wine and bread.
We want to wish Ashish, my husband, a very wonderful birthday, praying that this year will bring you even greater joy, even greater blessings, and even more favors from God.
Now, who wants to learn how to make the famous garlic shrimp pasta from the Holy Crab? We will be hosting a virtual cooking night with our very own Chef Henry William on Friday, April 16th at 6 p.m. via Zoom. He will be sharing with us his secret recipe so that we can make the very delicious garlic shrimp pasta ourselves at home. You can sign up through our website at vancouvercbc.org/cookingnight, and the ingredients list will be sent to you a week prior so that you will have time to shop for the ingredients and join us for a virtual cooking night. Be sure to join us. This will be fun. We are also hosting a virtual food drive in support of the Greater Vancouver Food Bank. And as a church, we're hoping to reach $500 to support our community. If you have a heart to donate and be a part of this outreach, please be sure to put down your name when providing the donation so that we can be entering you into a giveaway where you can win 2 Indonesian noodles, again, made by our very famous Chef Henry. So all the information are provided in the link below, so be sure to also take part in that.
Have a great service, everyone.
Good morning, church. Welcome to our Passover service. Today we're going to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus. Amen. Before that, let's pray. Father, we just want to thank you, God. Thank you, God, for 2,000 years ago, you died on the cross. And 2,000 years ago, you rose again, Lord. We just want to thank you, God. We want to celebrate your victory. We want to celebrate, Lord, your resurrection. We thank you in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Let's just sing the song, This is Amazing Grace. for me.
You know.
you, Jesus.
I will come. testing me clean. You have washed away my sin, and your blood has made me clean. I will come, I will sing. I will come.
Welcome to our Saturday service. We just want to take this time to welcome anyone who's new to our church, wherever you're watching from, whether you're from Vancouver or if you're somewhere else around the world. We're so glad to have you here with us. If you're new here, feel free to scroll to our Join Us page on our website at www.vancouvercbc.org, and a member of our church will connect with you.
We also have Carousel, which is a small group where we can get together for fellowship and also to share about our moments with God. We have 4 different Carousel at the moment. Feel free to contact us and we'll be happy to give you more information. Join us if you're looking for a community.
We also have Foundation Class that is open and you can sign up online on our website. Foundation Class is great for learning basics of Christianity, and it's also a great starting point for you if you're a new Christian.
I hope you can stay connected with us. Our church is on Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. You can check out our page for the latest news and updates of what our church is doing.
We have a lot of exciting things going on, and we definitely want you to be a part of it.
All right. Thank you, everyone, and have a wonderful Saturday.
Bye. Bye.
Good morning, church. How are you doing? I hope you guys are doing well. So today I want to share a little bit of my testimony on how God has helped me throughout my lows. As most of you guys know, I used to work in a bank as a card advisor. It is more like a customer service role. And to be really honest, this is not the job that I want to do in my career, just because like the stressful nature of the job, as well as it also doesn't help me with getting my PR applications later. But at the time, just because we are in this pandemic and I don't have much options available at the time, so I decided it's the best for me to take this job and apply for a job that I really want later. But turns out it's not as easy as I thought, just because to be really honest, I didn't think that this pandemic will last this long. And then second thing is just there's no job posting available on the market, so it's really hard for me to apply for the job. Even if I got some applications and I got some interviews, none of them were working out for me at the time. So when we did corporate fasting, I prayed to God asking for direction and pointers of what He wants me to do for my career. But on February 2021, it just came to the point that I was really stressed when doing my job. It affects my mental health, affects my stress level, it affects my anxiety level, and in fact my daily life as well, which is really bad for my mental health. So I came to a conclusion that I need to quit from this job, and I informed God about my decision. At the time, I feel like it is really a bad decision, but I don't really have any choices, just because I was really stressed. Because literally I'm raising myself with the possibility of not having a job and also not producing any income for the next 2 or 3 months, because I know that during this pandemic it will not be as it will be really hard for me to actually apply for another job and secure a job. But yeah, this is the when God shows His mercy to me and show His power to me. So at the time I was applying to a job, So I applied to PHSA as a financial analyst. At the time, this is the position that I really want, and I have applied to PHSA multiple times in the past, but none of my applications were actually working out. So I really have low expectations for this job applications, but someone from PHSA on the next day after I applied reaches me out, and we did phone screening. So thankfully the phone screening went well, and then they would like to move on for the next stage, which is an interview with managers. So they scheduled an interview with my managers at the time, in the next 2 or 3 days. I don't remember exactly the date, but it was around that. And I went to the interview with the managers, and thankfully and praise to the Lord, everything went well. So this is the weird part, because usually after the interview, I usually send a thank you letter, and usually employers will not respond the thank you letter for either in the next day or two. But in this case, they responded to me almost immediately. They say that they like my profile and they would like to move on to the next step, which is reference check, which is really surprising for me, just because I've applied to multiple job applications in the past, but none of them were actually this fast. The entire process is only take like almost like 4 days. So like, I feel like this is really, really a blessing from God, and this is something not that I can do by myself. So on the next day, to make it sure that in the next day, they informed me that I got the job, and then the best thing is I secured the job literally like before I informed my managers at the bank that I was going to resign. So my biggest fear at that time is actually being solved by God, because at the time I'm afraid that I will not be able to secure a job before resigning from my position in the bank, and God has helped me to secure the job before I resigned. So it was really great experience, and it was really a blessing from God. So the reason why I want to share you my testimony is just to remind you that how God can help you in everyday situations. I know during this pandemic, everyone has a lot of problems, has a lot of their own issue, but I just want to remind you that God is bigger than your problems. And even each time that you feel like you're stuck with the situation that you're dealing with, I want to remind you, and I would like to encourage you to actually pray more and surrender everything to your to God's hands, and let Him help you in your life to solve this issue. Hopefully this testimony can be useful for you guys in church. And thank you so much for listening. God bless you all and stay safe.
Good morning, Vancouver City Blessing Church. This is Pastor Zulwi Leon from Boston City Blessing. What a joy and tremendous honor it is for me to be able to minister before you again, especially in such a glorious day of our Lord. Let me begin by saying this before I get to my sermon, how much I really appreciate and love your lead pastor, Pastor Ivan and Joanne Jonathan. Now, I've watched how they minister, and I know that they are somebody who really love God, who really love the Word of God, and they really love the church. They love you. And I've been working and ministering and walking together with them for quite some time. And let me tell you, you guys are so blessed to have them. And Pastor Ivan and Joanne, Jonathan, I really appreciate you, appreciate your friendship with me and also Boston City Blessing Church. And I also want to acknowledge your founding pastor, which is also considered to be my spiritual pastor as well, Pastor Peter and Nani Tayu. And let me tell you, Pastor Peter And Pastor Nani has been a figure that has been responsible to be a mentor and leader to so many younger pastors such as myself. And Pastor Peter and Pastor Nani, thank you so much for your generous spirit and for your faithfulness that has enabled and paved the way for young pastors such as me to flourish and continue to serve. Thank you for your example. And God will repay all the seeds that you have sown into the life of other people by the breakthrough and successes that your church and your descendants will experience. Amen, amen, amen. Well, we've got so many grounds to cover, so let's get ready and let's begin by a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for this glorious day. And we rejoice because Christ has risen. He has risen indeed. And this morning, oh God, help us. Holy Spirit, guide us throughout every step of your word so that we will experience the power of your word, so that every person who shall hear this message be encouraged and be transformed by the power of your resurrection. We thank you, Jesus. In your mighty name we pray. Amen. 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 Well, Christ has risen. He is risen indeed. Happy Easter and happy Resurrection Sunday once again. Let's open our Bible passage to the Gospel of John, chapter 20. The Gospel of John, chapter 20, verse 1 to verse 18. But I'm not going to read the whole passage in one run. We're going to divide it throughout the sermon. And I'm reading from the New International Version. It's about the empty tomb. John, chapter 20, verse 1. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strip of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen just lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. And finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. I'm going to stop right there. I'm going to continue the rest of the passage later on. Now, I love a good movie. I don't know about you. And I seem to draw a lot of lessons from time to time from a good movie. Now, in the motion picture, the movie is only as good as the storyline. And one of the common technique in presenting the narrative of the storyline is this thing called flashback. What is a flashback? A flashback in a movie is a scene that takes place before a story begins. It interrupts the chronological orders of the main narrative to take a reader back into the time to the past event in a character's life, in the main character's life. In the literature, a writer used this device, used flashback as a measure to help readers better understand the characters, the present-day elements, the surrounding story, or to learn more about the character. So basically, they introduce flashback so that you get better understanding about the present circumstances that the main character, or even about the main character. You know, It's a way to enhance the present by going back to the past. Now, usually they introduce this by a way of reminiscing or causing the main character to reminisce about the past. One of the best movies that used this technique is one of my favorite movies, and this movie has earned 13 Academy Awards nomination and won 6 of them. including Best Picture, Best Actor, and Best Leading Role. You know, and also 7 Golden Globes nomination, and of which they won three, and many other awards such as Golden Globes, MTV Award, Screen Actors Guild. You care to guess which one is it? That movie is a movie that was casted out in 1994. It's called The Forrest Gump. Forrest Gump. It's played by Tom Hanks. And in the opening scene of the movie, the main character, which is Tom Hanks, can be seen sitting on a bench of a bus stop. And he began by picking up a feather that was tossed by a wind that landed right between his dirty and worn out sneakers. He picked it up and then he opened up his suitcase. He was sitting on the bench with a suitcase and a box of chocolate. Remember that? And he opened his suitcase. He reached out for a book and he put that feather in the middle of that book and then closed the suitcase back. Now, when he opened that suitcase, you can quickly and briefly see what's inside. You know, there's a Curious book, Curious George children book. You can see a bubblegum baseball cap. You can see a ping pong bat. Now, when I watched the movie for the first time, I didn't care. I didn't pay too much attention on that scene. And I thought it's just part of the director's a way of illustrating an artistic detail of a single scene. That's just a single scene. But when the storyline progressed to a flashback, and I begin to realize that apparently every single item that was showcased in that single scene, apparently every single one of them has a significance. It's tied to a greater meaning and it serves a greater purpose. And what's more, all these little pieces, it contributes greatly to the whole storyline of the movie. So in this case, the writer, helped by the director, of course, beautifully showcase a meaningful story of the present narrative by utilizing flashback. And in fact, if you watch this movie, you know, majority of the movie would go back and forth, you know, from that bus stop bench and then flashback into the past. You know, I think about 3/4 of the movie is about that. This flashback helped us to understand many things in the present narrative of the storyline. So a lot of the things that are happening in the present time in that movie made sense because of the flashback. Now, I felt that the same approach can be utilized for us this morning as we revisit the scene of Christ's resurrection. I do believe that we won't be able to understand fully or get deeper appreciation of this passage that we just read in John chapter 20 until we reminisce on the past events that preceded this. And there are so many symbols, so many pieces and bits in the story of resurrection in John chapter 20 that every single one of them, if you just read and glance through it, it could be, it's a beautiful nevertheless, you know, but it could be just something that we rehearse every year comes Easter. But I do believe that if we utilize the same approach of flashback and look at what exactly is the significance of it by referring to a previous passage that is available in the Bible, and we will get an enhanced meaning of what was being written, what was being illustrated in John chapter 20. Otherwise, we're going to arrive at the same pitfall that the disciples experienced in verse 8, 9, 10, after Simon and John arrived to the scene. It was written on verse 8, he saw and believed, but still did not understand. I felt like for the most part, we are like that. I mean, we believe, but we don't really understand the significance of it, you know. I believe that God would want us to fully understand, and not only understand, but experience the power, the significance, the purpose, and the meaning of every single items that is listed in this story. Now let's continue to read on the rest, the remaining passage of John 20. Verse 11 is when Jesus appears to Mary Magdalene. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and one at the foot, so on each end. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, and thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic. So apparently she realized that was Jesus. She turned and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus says, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. And this is the rest of the passage that illustrate about the story of the resurrection. Now, if we employ the right technique of flashback, I believe that John chapter 20 can be fully understood if you compare it with the story of the previous passage about the fall of man in the beginning, as in found in Genesis chapter 3. Now, you may not realize that there are so many symbols that were being represented that if you compare it to Genesis chapter 3, you will see a mirror image of parallel. And upon understanding this, you begin to understand the significance of John chapter 20 even greater. And let's begin by noticing the similarities of these two passages. Amen. Now, we know that the Genesis chapter 3 illustrates the fall of man into sin. That's when sin entered the human race for the first time. Now, in that passage and John chapter 20, there are several similarities that we need to pay attention to. The first thing that we need to notice, that there are two gardens on both of these stories. Now, we understand that man's first fall happens in a garden called Eden. Now, understand the significance of that this garden called Eden is actually a place that represents, that gives us a vivid picture of an intimate fellowship between man and God. This is a place of communion between man and his creator. And after Adam and Eve rebel from God, they disobeyed him. What was happened is that the Lord began to curse the ground and separation began to take place, and man was driven out of the garden. Now, if we read in John chapter 20 on Resurrection Sunday, Christ appeared in a garden. Are you serious, Pastor? Yes. Because the truth about that tomb, if you remember in John chapter 19, a rich man by the name of Joseph of Arimathea donated his new tomb. And if you read in John chapter 19, verse 41, you will discover at the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden. And in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. So yes, it's a tomb, but it is a tomb that is located in the middle of a garden. Now, I do believe that is not coincidence, but I believe that this garden was there for a purpose. I think God is trying to connect the dots, you know, from the past narrative into the present narrative, just like that story in Forrest Gump. You know, if you watch the whole movie, when he begins to pick up that feather that fall between his dirty and worn out sneakers, because I've watched that movie several times, I immediately am reminded of one scene where he ended up running cross country using that sneakers. And there's a reason why that sneakers is worn out. There's a reason why that sneaker is dirty, because those are the same pair that he used to trek across the states. So in the same way, there's a reason why there was a garden, and there's a reason why Jesus on the Resurrection Sunday, he appeared in a garden. I think this story wants to illustrate to us that because of redemption, because of what Christ has overcome, because of resurrection, intimate fellowship with God, which was represented in the garden, is now becoming available again. I think this story serves to remind us that at his resurrection, Jesus was reopening the doors to Eden again. Now, you know, in the other passages on the gospel, Mary on the journey, you know, wondered with the other girls, who's going to roll the stone away? Because that stone that closed the tomb, you know, is estimated to be 2.5 tons. It's a very big and heavy stone. You know, not even the 12 disciples combined could lift it that easy. But God rolled the stone for them. Now, hear me out when I say this. The stone was rolled away not just so that Jesus can come out, but God was rolling out the stone so that the people can come in and see it for themselves, that Christ has risen. He has risen indeed. And look at the tomb. It is empty. He is not here anymore. God is rolling out the stone just because it's not for Christ. It's not like Christ was, you know, pounding on the door, let me out. No. He's rolling out the stone so that you and I get to see it, get to come closer, that we once again can approach to the intimate fellowship that once was there in the garden, but ripped because of sin. So these two gardens, it's not just their coincidence, but there are such straight lines that was being painted between the past narrative and the present narrative of this story. The second similarities that is worth noticing is the fact that in these two stories, there are two women involved. Now, when sin enters the world, when the devil seduces mankind, it enters by way of deceiving the first woman, which is Eve. You know, in Genesis chapter 3, verse 1 to 3, you will easily read it. But on Resurrection Sunday, after Christ has defeated Satan through his atoning death, Jesus appeared first to a woman. It's interesting that Jesus did not choose to be seen by his glorious disciple or by some noble man or by some ruler or king or even the centurion maybe that guarded him. But no, in the story it was clear that the first to appear, the first to discover, the first to see the resurrection, and the first to be commissioned too with a message of the resurrection is none other than a woman. And this woman is not just any woman. We know the significance of Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene was one who had previously been in bondage to Satan's capture, to his demon. John chapter 20, verse 14, Luke chapter 8, verse 2, will tell you, Mary called Magdalene, from whom seven demons had came out. Mary became followers of Christ because he experienced the power of God's deliverance and has been following Christ till the end. And she was the one that God chose, and she was the one to experience and to hear and to see the resurrection. And we know that Mary Magdalene is the New Testament counterpart to Eve. It's a type of Eve. Her life reminds us that Jesus offers us total deliverance from the bondage of our past. You know, his resurrection gives us an understanding that he's restoring intimate fellowship that was broken by sin. And when he appeared to Mary, actually, it is a message to us that God is promising a total deliverance from the bondage of our past, that regardless whatever our life has been, God can give peace to our past, purpose to our present, and hope for our future. And that story was well encapsulated in the story of Mary, the one who is first to to see the resurrection of Christ. Now, the third similarities is the fact that there were mentioning of gardeners in both of these two passages. You know, if we flash back to Genesis chapter 3, in the story of the fall, we understand that Adam's first assignment in that garden was to tend the garden. So he was the official gardener of the whole earth. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 5, verse 8, verse 15, it was so beautifully laid down there. It says that when God created the whole earth, nothing was growing yet. Number one, because rain did not fall. And number two, it says because there were no people to cultivate the soil. And then not later until God created man. God created Adam. And then verse 8 says, then the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he placed the man he had made. Verse 15 says, the Lord God placed the man in the garden of Eden to tend and watch over it. That makes Adam the tender of the garden, or the gardener, the keeper of the garden. Now, in the same way, on Easter morning, let me tell you something, this is not a coincidence. Mary Magdalene met a man outside of the tomb that she mistook for a gardener. She thought was a gardener. But when she realized it was Jesus, she cried out, Rabboni. Now, we understand in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 45 to 47, verse 22, there was that parallel line being drawn between Adam and Jesus. Adam being the first man and Jesus being the last Adam. The first Adam was set to fail, but the last Adam will succeed. In verse 45, it is written, the first man Adam became a living being, but the last Adam, which is Jesus, a life-giving spirit. If Adam was the first gardener of the Garden of Eden, that he was later driven out because of sin, then Jesus, the last Adam, was the gardener of this garden of resurrection. The first man was the dust of the earth. The second man is of heaven. Wow. You know, this couldn't have been a coincidence. It's just something nice to be put out there. Remember, in any good movie, both the writer and the director create this movie so beautifully so that we can get this beautiful narrative, beautiful picture. And we know that in this Bible, the writer and the director is the same person. God is the master orchestrator of everything. And this is not just a coincidence, but he placed it there as a mirror image to paint a beautiful picture. I hope you begin to see the beauty of the present story about the resurrection by going back, flashback to the Genesis, to the story of the past that makes this story even more beautiful, that gives meaning and reveal to us the clearer significance and purpose of every role, every piece that is right there. And then, number four, the last similarities was the fact that it was mentioned there are two sets of angels. After Adam and Eve fell into sin, what God did when he drove Adam and Eve out of the garden is that he posted cherubim. Now, cherubim is a plural name of cherub, which is an angel. So cherubim, two angels were set there with a flying sword, you know, sword of fire to guard them from coming back. Now on the Eastern morning, it says there in John chapter 20 that there are two angels appear in the garden. But the difference was that if the first two angels in the book of Genesis was there to keep men from going back to the garden and partake of the life of a tree of life, the second angel on the Gospel of John was there not to banish mankind from the presence of God, but this angel is there to invite us to behold the risen Messiah and to become partaker of the mercy of God and to be reconciled to an intimate fellowship with God anymore. This is not an angel that carries a flying, a fiery sword. But this is an angel that rolls down the stone and makes the way, paved the way for those who are tired, weary, thirsty, and hungry to be able to be partaker of salvation in Jesus Christ. These two angels are not there to banish mankind like it was in the book of Genesis. But these angels are here to re-invite us again to behold the risen Messiah. You know, this is something that is so beautiful. You know, after I watched that movie several times, then every time I watch that movie again, because that movie is so good, right about the first scene when he was sitting on that bench and opening that suitcase, every single piece, for down from the dirty and worn out sneakers to every little piece that is in that suitcase, now it comes alive to me. When I saw that, it's as if a movie is being played on my mind of that particular scene. Church, that is exactly how we should read the story of the resurrection. Because what was written in this passage, it is addressing what has happened before. But it is not just telling you as it is, but it is perfecting it, bringing it into perfection to us. Now, there is another character that was mentioned in the story of John chapter 20, but it was not being emphasized in the Gospel of John. But in the Gospel of Mark, if you read from the version of the Gospel of Mark, Mark chapter 16, right about the time when Mary was being commissioned to bear the news of resurrection, in verse 7, this is how it sounds. It says, "But go, tell his disciples and Peter." Go tell his disciples and Peter. So actually, in this story about resurrection, number one, there are two figures that are actually showcased, aside from, of course, the Messiah, Jesus himself. The first one we spoke lengthy previously is Mary, one who was once under the bondage. And Mary, by the way, represents a group that was actually marginalized so severely in a patriarchal culture of the Jews, because back in the day, women are considered to be of lesser authority. In fact, they would not accept the testimony of women in the court. That's why Mary was not so kind to, keen on sharing about the story of resurrection, but just to the disciples, because she was afraid she will be think of as a lunatic, someone crazy. And the second one is Peter. Now, the Gospel of Mark paints us an even more elaborate picture about how God addressed Peter more than the Gospel of John. In the Gospel of Mark chapter 16, specifically it says to Mary, "Go tell his disciples and Peter." Now, why Peter? I mean, this also can be best understood if we go a flashback couple chapters earlier, you know, as in Gospel of Matthew chapter 26, we will find out. Now, many scholars believe that it was addressed, "Go tell the disciples and Peter," because when Peter denied Jesus three times, by default, Peter has forfeited his discipleship or apostleship. And that's why he is no longer counted as members of the disciples. But I, for one, believe it is more than just that. I think there's a reason why God specifically point out his name. To me, by understanding what happens before, if we go flashback in Matthew 26, how Peter disowned Jesus. Peter basically disowned Jesus. But what really captured my heart is the last passage in the first 74. Then, verse 73 was when the third accuser said to Peter, "Surely you are one of them. Your accents give you away." Then he began to not only deny Jesus, but he began to call down curses. And he swore to them, "I do not know the man." And immediately a rooster crowed. Then Peter remembered the word Jesus had spoken, "Before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times." And he went outside and wept bitterly. Now, I mean, what happens after that? We know that Jesus was tried, and then he was tortured, and then he was crucified, and contrary to what all of them expected, he died. So those was Peter's last tribute to his master, denying him three times. Can you imagine being him? Can you imagine if you parted ways with somebody that you love, but instead of good memories, you left out a bad memories, and you were never, you felt like, oh, there's never any opportunity for me to make amends or to undo what I have done. And that's exactly, and even more than what I could have vocalized, that's how Peter felt. He wept bitterly. He cried out. And to me, this is why John chapter 20 speaks of a great volume of God's mercy. Because the God of the whole universe has seen it fit to include a person that is outcast, marginalized, a group that was represented in Mary Magdalene. Somebody, number one, she is a woman. Number two, she is a woman with reputation. But nevertheless, she became the one, the first to discover God's resurrection. And then the second is a man who has experienced what it's like to fall from glory. Peter, who once walked on water. Peter, who has been walking with Christ, who were known to be one of Jesus' closest disciples, who was there at Mount of Transfiguration, ended up denying Jesus. But God is not only a God who heals us, but God is also a God who can restore us. And when he includes Peter in the story of resurrection, my brothers and my sisters, you and I ought to be rejoicing. You and I ought to be shouting for joy and dancing, or whatever it is that you use to express your excitement, because between these two figures, it pretty much covered all the sinners, all those who fall short. You know, the letters in Romans, Paul says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Within these two figures, I think it encapsulates those who have fallen short of the glory of God. But then again, in the story of his resurrection, he addressed these two people. Oh, beloved in the Lord, church, this is something that is so good. And this is being written, this is being revealed for you and I. I think the writer and the director in this movie, in this story, which is God the Almighty himself, beautifully showcase a meaningful story of the present by showcasing the flashback. How ugly, how devastating, how painful sin was. But then again, he finished it by showcasing how awesome, how gracious, how powerful, how beautiful is the power of God's mercy when he addressed the like of Mary Magdalene and Simon Peter. God is writing this love story to address all the Marys and the Peters, and that is you and I. He is using this story. Remember, he says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. I hope now even that word gives you a new meaning when you see all the connection of this story. I hope by now every single one of us, all of you who are listening to this message, get to know that God really, 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 really loves you. He really means it when he says he loves you. He loves you enough that like Peter, he called you by name. He knows your name. He called Mary by name. He knows who you are. He knows what you're going through. He knows what you've been struggling. And yet, you are not too far from him. and yet He cared enough to call you by name. And when He called you, He's not judging you, but He is calling you to Himself so that you can experience restoration. You can experience again intimate fellowship that was broken because of sin. Let me close with this story, and then I want to give you an opportunity to open your heart and receive His grace. In verse 5, 6, and 7, there was a piece of item that was mentioned there that also, unless you flash back to the past, you won't understand the significance of it. And this is verse 5. He bent over, this was Simon Peter and John, look into the tomb, right? Look in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Did you notice that? Why would a particular piece of cloth, a type of cloth, being mentioned three times in that passage? You know, and as I mentioned earlier, every piece in this story is meaningful and has a significance. And if you want to understand the significance of a linen, you got to flash back into the day of the Old Testament. Now, it is interesting that Jesus, when He died, He was wrapped with linen. There was a story, there was a tradition, there was a teaching back in the day of the Old Testament in the Levitical priests, in Leviticus chapter 16, verse 1 to 4, in Ezekiel chapter 44, verse 17 to 18. Back when God was instituting the priestly of Aaron, you know, the high priest would be wearing, the like of Aaron would be wearing a very glorious robe. A very glorious robe. It's called the ephod, with all the, you know, gems, you know, representing 12 tribes, and with glorious. But once a year, God would ask even the high priests to change, to throw down their robe, and instead to put on linen. And you know what? Those linen was actually the robe that is worn by regular priests. You know, the high priest has a special robe, but the regular priests wear the linen. And once a year, back in the day of Mosaic Temple, there was this area called the Holy of Holies. That's where the Ark of Covenant is. Not everybody can enter. Only the high priest can enter. And once a year, in the day that is known as the Day of Atonement, or what is called Yom Kippur, the assigned high priest must come into that Holy of Holies and to bring the sacrifice of atonement. You know, so, and the way he is to enter in Leviticus chapter 16, verse 1 to 4, it says in verse 4, this is how Aaron is to enter the most holy place. He must bring young bull for a sin offering and a ram for a burnt offering. Verse 4, he is to put on sacred linen tunic, linen undergarment next to his body. He is to tie the linen sash around him and to put on the linen turban. These are sacred garments, so he must bathe himself with water before he puts them on. What is interesting is that in Ezekiel, it was spelled out that the priests are not to wear wool material, because wool will perspire, but instead to wear linen. And this is the attire that the high priest is to wear when he is to enter once a year in the Day of Atonement, a day where they present sacrifice to atone for their sin in Yom Kippur. And back then, only the chosen priest can enter. And if, let's say, the priests were not sanctified, or the offering of sacrifice were not accepted, the priest will die. That's why they used to tie a rope on one of the feet, on one of the ankle of the high priest that is scheduled to enter, so that if they die, they can pull out. Nobody can enter but the chosen priests. Now, the priests were to go in into the Holy of Holies, present a sacrifice, and if he was accepted, if the sacrifice were accepted, he were to come out. And the whole time the people in the courtyard outside were waiting nervously. Will our sacrifice be accepted? And if the sacrifice were accepted, the priest were to come out and cry out a simple declaration: forgiven, forgiven, forgiven. Now, look at the beautiful story. If we read it, glance it, just read it, separate each of them, one would make it a beautiful resurrection story, interesting detail, linen, and one would make an interesting historical fact of the mosaic priestly garment. But when you compare this together, it gives you a whole new meaning. This is a beautiful picture. Nobody can enter death. Nobody can enter into the Holy of Holies, only the chosen high priest. And nobody can conquer death. Nobody can enter death and go back from death to become alive again, but our chosen high priest, which is Jesus. And on the day of the crucifixion, our high priest, Jesus, you know, he sacrificed himself on the cross. And then he was placed into that tomb, wrapped in a linen. The high priest entered into that chamber that no one can enter. But the critical question is, does the sacrifice took? Does the sacrifice, was it accepted? No one knows. And the only validation that will tell you that the sacrifice is enough and accepted is when he came out from death. And that is exactly what happened in the story of resurrection. Jesus, our high priest, adorned with his robe of linen, entered, defeated death, and came out from death, and proclaimed to the whole world, to you and I, forgiven, forgiven, forgiven. Church, this is a great news for you and I. He is addressing this to every single one of us, to the Marys and to the Peters. He's saying, I have forgiven you. Now there is a forgiveness from God to all of you if you would just come and receive it. That's why it is very important that this message arrive to the disciples and especially Peter, so that Peter knows that your denial, your refusal of me is not the end of your life. There is another chance. There's another way. You can be forgiven. You can be restored. No matter how bad you have had it, no matter how severely bonded you are, no matter how broken, no matter how destroyed your life is, just like Mary Magdalene, a man that was once plagued with so many demons, just like Peter who fell from such glory. But the message today in this resurrection is that you can have glorious expectation in the Lord because of what our high priest has accomplished by dying on the cross, buried, and resurrected. He is saying, forgiven, forgiven, forgiven. Vancouver City Blessing Church, receive this message this morning. And I want to invite you this morning, to those of you who are listening to this message for the first time, or maybe you've heard this, but just like the disciples, maybe in certain degree you believe it, but you do not understand. I want to encourage you this morning to receive this and adopt this as your faith. Receive the hand that he extended to you, that if you would receive him this morning, that if you would welcome him, that this will no longer be just another story, but this becomes your story of salvation this morning. And I guarantee that you will be living a brand new life. Then things in your life will begin to make sense. Just like you watched that movie, things in the present narrative begin to make sense and begin to be meaningful because of your understanding of the past, of what he has done for you. And that is exactly my prayer. This morning, I want to represent God. And just like Mary, she was the first one that was commissioned with the message, tell the disciples that I have risen. I want to tell you, God has risen. God has risen to all of the occasion of your falling. God has risen for all your problem, for all your challenges, for all of your shortfalling, for all of your hang-ups, setbacks, shortcomings. He has risen and defeated all those. This morning, would you open your heart and just receive Him? And if that's really your desire, I want to encourage you this morning. You can pray along with me, and it's just a simple prayer. If you would just bow down your head and just say this prayer with me. Father, I want to thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross for me. Today, I want to receive his sacrifice. I want to receive his forgiveness. And today, just like Mary and like Peter, I want to be restored. I want to be set free. I want to be healed from my condemnation. I want to have hope again. I want to receive peace for my past. I want to receive purpose for my present. And I want to receive hope for my future. So this morning, Jesus, I invite you to come into my life. Be my Lord and my Savior. Forgive my sin. And guide me for the rest of my life. Today, I give you my heart. I give you my life. For your kingdom and for your glory. That my life will glorify your name forever and ever. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, amen. Now, if you have just said that prayer, allow me to be the first person to congratulate you and welcome you into the kingdom of God. And I promise you, this will be a new life with a new adventure that will be beyond your wildest expectation. So today, in the story of resurrection, God is giving us glorious expectation. And I pray that you receive it this morning by faith. In Jesus' name, amen.
Now we are going to partake the Holy Communion. Every first Saturday of the month, we do the Holy Communion together as a church. The bread represents the body of Christ that is broken for sinful men. And the cup represents the blood of Christ that was shed for sinful men for cleansing sin. While we're preparing for the elements, let me read one scripture from John chapter 6, verse 53 to 56. John chapter 6, verse 53 to 56. So Jesus said again, I tell you the truth, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you cannot have eternal life within you. But anyone who eats my flesh and drinks my blood have eternal life, and I will raise that person at the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Anyone who eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in him. So are you ready, church? Let's take the bread and the cup together, and let's pray. Lord Jesus, we want to thank you for what you've done for us. You came and you died for us on the cross to save us from our sin and eternal death. And you rose again from death to give us hope and future. As we are partaking this Holy Communion, the bread and the wine, we are declaring your healing power for our body, your cleansing redemption for our soul, and your divine blessing for our life. Thank you, Lord Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So let us eat and drink together the bread and the wine in Jesus' name.
One, two, three, Jesus. sings alive. One, two, three. Jesus sings alive. He died for you and me, but on day three, Jesus rose again. Jesus sings alive. God loved the world.
I want to say thank you to Pastor Zulfi for blessing us with the Word of God for today. We are so blessed. Thank you, Pastor. And thank you to the team who preparing the service for all of us here. Thank you to Kevin for your wonderful testimony. And also to the VCB kids for a wonderful presentation for all of us today. Well done. Thank you so much. So church and friends, I want to say blessed Passover to you all, to you and your family. Amen. Believing that the blessing of Jesus Christ, the blessing of His resurrection, because Jesus is alive, so we can face tomorrow. There's hope and future in Him. Amen? So stay safe and be blessed, and I will see you again next week. God bless you all. Bye-bye.